Now, will you notice how God is going to meet this situation? How is he going to answer it? He very frankly faces it. Listen to what God has to say. Verse 4. Yet now be strong, O Zerubbabel, saith the Lord, and be strong, O Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and be strong, all ye people of the land, saith the Lord, and work. For I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts. May I say to you, this is quite wonderful. God's challenge was twofold here. He says it three times, be strong. Be strong, he says, to the civil ruler. Be strong, he says, to the religious ruler. He now speaks to the people, and he has something new for them. No, same thing. Be strong. Be strong. And that was a very wonderful thing to say to them. Very simple, of course, but frankly, very important. You remember, this is something that Paul said to the Ephesians. You and I today live in a big, bad world. What's our encouragement today? God's work in so many places seems so small, doesn't seem to amount to very much. What is the answer to it? Well, here's God's answer. Ephesians 6, verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That's the important thing. If you can recognize you can't do anything, but God can do a great deal, and be strong in the Lord. Well, how wonderful that is. And may I say to you, that is something we find over in the 11th chapter of Hebrews, verse 34. It says there that they quench the violence of fire, escape the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong. And doesn't God say he chooses the weak things of this world? God doesn't choose these big, highly ornate buildings today, these great big mausoleums that have a steeple on top of them. Nothing very great's happening in those places today, friends. I'll tell you where the place is just jumping today. It's out in the suburban areas, or in actually a small place where the church is just absolutely packed out. Now, I know what I'm talking about when I mention this. I've had the privilege of going across this country several times, and I have been abroad also. Why, I went into a great church in London, England. At one time, it was filled with several thousand people three times a week regularly. Well, the Sunday night I was there, there weren't 200 people there. May I say to you, my, that great, big, imposing building is not very impressive anymore with its very formidable name. Well, may I say to you, that's true in this country today. I have been in some of these great churches. By the amount of lumber you can see there that's in pews and in benches, nobody's in them. But I go out yonder today to some of these small churches, and they are packed to the door. And they're having two and three services a day. I've been in several churches now where they have three morning services. Somebody said, well, why don't you go back there? Because, my friend, three services in the morning kills me, but these young preachers are able to do it, apparently. So may I say to you that we're to be strong in the Lord. And he not only said that one time or two times, but Paul, writing to a young preacher in 2 Timothy, the second chapter, I'd like to read that. He says in chapter 2, verse 1 of 2 Timothy, now this is his swan song and is his final message to this young preacher, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. You're God's son now. He was a spiritual son, you see, of Paul. And Paul says, you are a son of God. Be strong now. And what a word of encouragement that should be. Somebody says, well, my work is so small, my little group is so small, that I don't think it amounts to very much. May I say to you, if that's what you think, it's the devil that's talking to you. It's God that, very frankly, is the one that's going to put the measuring rod down on it and determine who's great and who's not. And there are a whole lot of straw stacks that are being built today, and they're very impressive. I've always been afraid that I have built a big straw stack. And somebody says, yes, but some gold in it. But my friend, have you ever tried to find a needle in a straw stack? How would you find a little piece of gold that's the same color as a straw? May I say to you, friends, that it's not a matter of the size of the work to begin with. God makes it very clear that that's not the important thing. What he's saying to you and me today is, watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, be strong. That's 1 Corinthians 16:13. And that was a bunch of babies over there in Corinth. And Paul says, get out of the crib, get out of your high chair, and grow up, be strong in the Lord. Oh, how we need that sort of thing today in God's work, friends. And again, he wasn't through with the Corinthians. When he wrote the second epistle, he says to them in 2 Corinthians 10:4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. It was my privilege to be pastor in downtown Los Angeles and to have succeeded some great men that I always respected them. I may not approve of everything they did, but I sure had great respect for those men. They were great preachers. And Dr. Torrey had been the founder of that church. And so I never went in that pulpit, never walked in that pulpit. But what, when we left the radio room to come out on the platform with the staff, I always looked to God and would say to him, Lord, I am unable. I'm insufficient. And who is sufficient for this task? And I call on you today. And may I say to you that I'm thanking God that out of weakness, he can make you strong. And he says here, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And I've told God many a time, I said, Lord, if anything happens here today, you will have to do it, because you and I know that this poor boy can't do it at all. And he goes on to say, here to the Corinthians, verse 5, he says, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. In other words, make very sure you're being obedient unto God. And it doesn't make any difference how large the work is or how small the work is. It's something that we need to remember, be strong. God says, sure, this temple is not as impressive as the other temple was. God says, I know that, but be strong. That is my challenge to you. And he said it three times. And then he said something else. And work. And work. Just keep at the job. Let God be the one to determine who's doing the greatest work. I think when you and I get up there, we're going to find out that there may have been some people that were greater in Luther's day than Luther. And in Wesley's day, greater than Wesley. And greater than Billy Sunday in Billy Sunday's day, Billy Graham in Billy Graham's day, or even Vernon McGee. I used to tell the staff, I said, you know, someday when we stand before God, we may call some woman, and he'll say, this woman was a member of the Church of the Open Door while Dr. McGee was pastor of that church. Only thing, I don't think he'd call me doctor. But he'll say, I want to reward her. She is the most honored one. And I'll nudge members of the staff. I say, did you all know her? I didn't. And they said, no, we never heard of her. She's one of those unknown members. All she had was just one little boy. Her husband deserted her. She raised him. And he went to the mission field. And my, what a work he did. And she was faithful. She didn't have the opportunity of speaking to thousands, but she sure had the opportunity of speaking to one. And that's all God asked her to do. May I say to you, I think we're going to get our eyes open someday when we stand in His presence. He says, be strong and work. Be faithful at the task that God has called you to. And then here is the glorious word of encouragement. And it's this, for I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts. Now, we have a great deal more in this chapter to deal with, and especially in this particular section here. And I'm inclined to want to move on, but no, I want to stay with this for just a moment. God says, for I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts. Now, the fact of the matter is, the Shekinah glory had departed from the temple sometime before the destruction of the temple. Now, I've always taken the position that it took place during the reign of Manasseh. That man was a sinner and a ruler, and during his reign, that nation went lower than it ever had gone before. And if the Shekinah glory didn't leave during his reign, I'd be very frank with you, I can't figure out any other time after that that he'd be inclined to leave. I think he left during the reign of Manasseh. Now, they had this very ornate temple, boards covered with gold, all of it in display, and the silver, all of that. How beautiful it must have been. You know that on that place today is the Mosque of Omar. And it has a dome that is painted gold. Now, I've been told that that's gold leaf. I don't know. It may or may not be. I'm rather skeptical about those things, but it could be, of course. But I have looked at that from the Mount of Olives. I've looked at it from Zion. I've looked at it from the tower of that Lutheran church. I've looked at it from the hotel windows. And I want to see how it shines. And as I've looked at that pagan mosque, I've thought of how Solomon's temple must have looked in the bright sunlight of that almost desert air. How beautiful it must have been. And in comparison to what they're looking at now, why, there actually is no comparison at all. But friends, the Shekinah glory was gone. It wasn't there anymore. And this house that's being put up, and this is the thing I want to deal with next time, is that actually Zerubbabel's temple that is being rebuilt here now was torn down by Herod, and then Herod began to build that beautiful temple that was there in Christ's day, but never completed. In 70 A.D., Titus destroyed it. And the Lord always looked at that as one house, not three houses, but one house. And so he's going to talk about that a little later. But actually, the house they're putting up is in line with the house that will be there when the Lord Jesus comes and walks into that temple and cleanses it. Now, will you look at that for just a moment? He was the Shekinah glory. He was God manifest in the flesh. John says we beheld His glory, but He was veiled in human flesh, and He walked into that temple not one time, but many times. The Lord says to these people, yes, it's not much, but I'm with you. And that's better than having a temple and God not being there. And my friend, that's the contrast between that big church today with empty seats, nothing in the world but a mausoleum, cold and indifferent and dead, and a little church around the corner that's got a young man teaching the Word of God. I say to you today that we need to get a perspective of what is real and what is not real, and what God is blessing and what God is not blessing. This is a marvelous section here. We'll pick right up there next time, and until then, may God richly bless you, my beloved.